I don't want to set the world on fire. I just want to start a flame in your heart.
Welcome to the Cranberry Township Volunteer Fire Company. Hi, I'm Brian Kovac, Fire Company Chief. Back in 2009, our company celebrated its 50th anniversary. It's a great history, and we're fortunate to have some of our longest serving members with us today. This is their story in their own words.
Hi, my name is Jim Burke. I was the actual second fire chief of the company from 1960 to 1965. Before we started the company, we had to depend on other people. And that's what prompted us to start the company.
It's Wexford. Warrendale had a volunteer fire company, Xanople. They probably covered Cranberry at the time, Big Knob. Before that, Cranberry was probably 85% farms. The farmers, for whatever reason, would burn their fields, a lot of wood, or try to take a burn, and the wind, which is around that time of year, would get away from them. So almost every volunteer fire company at that time had some kind of, usually an old World War II four-wheel drive vehicle, but a brush truck of some kind.
One time we fought a field fire. Fought that fire for, I don't know, 5 or 6 days straight. It's hard to get at it, you know. We didn't have the equipment to go in there, and you had to use Indian fighters. 5-gallon can on your back and pump the water and use shovels and brooms, and that's how we fought that fire.
I had occasion to be called and to actually be involved in two accidents in which the individual was burned alive. Now, one of them was an individual who was inebriated. I helped the coroner pull him out. I mean, his foot was caught underneath the brake and the clutch. The other one that I was involved in was a woman who had just recently lost her husband. And when we got to the front of the vehicle, her body was down underneath the driver's seat. And it was a gory sight. They're the only two that I participated in that I recall, and sometimes I'd like to forget.
Late 50s, there was a fairly active civil defense organization. I think back then the Cold War was in effect, and people was worrying about the atomic bombs and that, so civil defense organizations were quite active. And those men there were sort of got together about trying to organize a fire company.
It was actually a 17 men that met one night in the old township building, which is now a historic site at our new township building. And we decided then that we were going to start a fire department. And everyone at that time said, yes, I can get this, I can get that.
The tanker, we got that from the civil defense. The old Mac, it was an old Mac army truck. And then we got a tank from Pryor's Milk Company up in Portersville and put on it. And we sort of like built that tanker ourselves. We put a pump on it and everything.
And civil defense helped the township acquire the Persh, a tanker, and a squad truck back in 59. The civil defense was able to acquire that stuff from the military, the Persh we bought from another fire company.
And the old Persh at that time, I used to be scared to death when somebody got on it and took off because it only had mechanical brakes. The brakes weren't very good. And if you were going fast, you bet you needed two people, somebody pushing on the brakes and the other one grabbing the parking brake. That's how they stopped it. Other than that, the Persh was good.
We built our own fire truck, we built our own field truck, we built our own tankers. We did a lot of the stuff ourselves because that's just the way it was done.
It was in 59, in that spring, we had a car raffle. We raffled off a 59 Pontiac. We was able to make enough on that car to get invest in our property, which we bought on Dutil Road, the old Route 19, the old fire station where the beer distributor is. I think it was 5 acres or 5.5 acres we got there, and it was an old barn.
We built our own station at the time. It was all done pretty much, a lot of the work was done by volunteers, the volunteer firemen.
We done it all. We laid block, we poured concrete, we done everything. And I mean the plumbing, the concrete, and the wiring.
First we had block layers, we had cement finishers, we had almost every craft that you could think of, and we built the first building. And then the ladies' auxiliary made Santa Clauses and sold Santa Clauses at Christmas to buy the doors of the building. The doors were $400 and they made $400.
Well, I'll tell you, with any female organization, I mean, God bless them, I mean, they deserve an awful lot of credit.
We had the Harper's, the truck stop across the street from Hartner's was a phone there. So if a person called the fire company, they would answer the phone and they would hit a button which would set off the fire alarm.
Father would call Harper's, Harper's would set off our sirens. We'd hear the sirens, go to the station, see where the fire was at, and we would respond to it that way.
There was another incident where an airplane came down right up off of Dover Drive in Fernway. And it was a Civil Air Patrol plane, and we never did find out what had happened.
Yeah, back then, the ambulance calls were pretty much handled by the local funeral homes, either Geonople or Mars. Or in 1969, we purchased a used 1963 Cadillac ambulance, and the fire company was also in the ambulance business.
Passageros, Drum and Bugle Corps. We started that for the teenagers because there wasn't a lot to do here. It was a marching group with the flags and the costumes and the batons and stuff like that. It gave the kids something. So that worked pretty well.
We had an awful lot of firemen parades at that time. And at this time of year was just open season on parades. Everybody took an awful lot of pride in what equipment we sent. And of course our group preceded us in the parade.
At that time, there wasn't a lot of emphasis on formal training and learned on the job.
Everybody was a firefighter then. You grabbed a broom, shovel, anything you had, and you fought fires, hands-on, yeah, fighting fires. It was no classroom at all, not at Butler, not when I went.
We did, right in our own fire hall, have training for new guys coming in to teach them to handle the fire equipment, the hoses and so forth, which we didn't have many back then. And we went to fire schools when they were offered to us. And when we went to the fire schools, the other companies that came in kind of felt sorry for us. And they offered us things that they didn't need anymore. We only had 6 coats for men and 6 boots and no pants. And so we were very glad to get that handout to us.
At first, whenever I came to the company, we did not have the AMPGUS, the rescue equipment, jaws of life, so to speak. And what we had were crowbars or anything we could to open up a door.
You know, back in those days, training for fire company was secondary. Fundraising was primary.
I can remember standing out on Route 19 selling raffle tickets, trying to flag the cars down to buy a ticket.
Every year we had a carnival in the summertime, and it involved almost 3 weeks of your time. We also had bingos, teen dances, adult dances. There was a lot of different things that went on to do fundraising. They did a door-to-door canvas for money, car raffles, gun raffles, all that kind of stuff. You did all those things just to try to raise money for the fire company.
You done more work inside the house or collecting money to take and run the fire company than what you spent fighting fires.
At that point in time, there was not a lot of friendly talk between the township supervisors and the fire company. The fire company looked at the supervisors as though they're the enemy. They really weren't, but there were certain people within the fire company from a long time ago that kept that going.
In the beginning, there was the three supervisors, and we got a little bit of money from the township, not very much. I think we were only getting $1,000 a year out of the township.
So we kept after the township to say, you know, what can you do to help us? What can be done in order to do this? Well, the township then sat down with the board of the fire company at that time and says, well, the only way we can figure out how to do it is to take over all your assets, buildings and your trucks, and then you would be part of the township, and then you would be put on a regular budget with the township.
Besides, the township would purchase all the equipment. Essentially, they would take over all the equipment and sell the new till station, and with the money raised from that and donation from the township, that they would build the hang station, and they would take care of all the expenses of the fire company operation.
Even back then, Cranberry was a progressive community. They always had a community comprehensive growth plan. Penn State had a program called the PennTAP program, where they studied all the components of the fire service and the fire protection of Cranberry. And then we developed a plan on where strategically, based on this study, the location of the fire station should be. We took the comprehensive growth plan that Cranberry had and combined the two. That's what we determined was the growth was going to outgrow us and outgrow our funding for the fire department. We decided to take it one step further, and we met with the township. We dressed up with the best we could at that time, and we introduced ourselves to the township supervisors, and we laid out our PennTAP study, and we laid out our graphs, and we explained to them that we had 28 concerns of issue with the growth of the fire department in the next 1, 3, 5, 10 years. They complimented us on our professional approach, and asked to step outside, and they caucused for a little bit, and we came back in. The fire department told us to go ahead and order our mini pumper, they would pay for it. And little did we know that they wanted to reach out to the fire department, and they were trying to figure out how. So it was one of those happen chance meetings to, they were thinking the same things we were, and we just happened to knock on a door, and it started a whole new era. I remember the night of the election to go with the agreement, it was the night the vote we had. I think the vote was like 22-18. Because every life member, every person come out of the woodwork to vote against it. They were against it, and they thought we were selling the fire department down the road. That's understandable. I mean, people have their beliefs, and those people prior to me worked their butts off for this fire department. They built that station of going through with their bare hands. They begged, borrowed, they got the bricks, they laid the bricks, they laid the roofs, they put the roof on. They had a vested interest in who we were and what we were.
I mean, whenever you work all that time and build something and build everything from scratch, you do it all your own, make your own money and everything, and they come in and they wanted to take over everything, more or less. Now, it was hard to swallow at the time. I was against it at the time, but I know that was a big mistake, because I'm for it 100% now.
It was a real experiment at the time, because there wasn't nobody else that did that. And it was trying to see, will it develop? Well, as you can see today, it has been one of the greatest things that ever happened to this fire company, because we have the latest equipment, buildings, and everybody seems to be satisfied with one another.
These guys today, I don't know how they do it. You gotta go to school for everything. Back in our days, first one there drove the truck, you know what I mean. You drove the truck, and first one there usually hopped on a truck and got it warmed up, and everybody come, they pile in the back. We didn't have a cab to ride in, we rode in the back. it was a great experience, I'll never forget it. Had a lot of good times.
It's enjoyable. You get a good feeling when you save somebody's house.
The fire service isn't about putting fires out. It's about people, about the people in the organization, the people we protect and serve in our community. And when they get back, it really is truly a brother and sisterhood, because when they get back to the fire station and all the joking and things that go on, even after bad incidents. There's a lot of things go on. That's your way to relieve some of the stress. And that's the importance of it. That's what creates the brotherhood and the sisterhood and makes everybody want to be a part of what happens.
In my heart I have but one desire, and that one is you. No other will